Good evening, everybody. Today we are for the second lecture in the series of Pursue 1B Uropathology. And today we will be talking about approach to pediatric renal tumor. Dr. Indranil Das will take this topic, and we had discussed adult renal tumors last time. So I think let's hand over to Dr. Indranil Das. Dr. Das, please take over.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, you're live, Dr. Das. Please share your screen.
Sir, can you see that, my screen?
Not yet.
Yeah,
that's fine. You can share the full screen.
Okay, sir, thank you. Okay. Good evening, everyone. Hello, I'm Dr. Indranil Das from India. Today I'm going to discuss pediatric kidney tumor. In the last class, we discussed about adult kidney tumor. The handling of pediatric kidney tumor is little different, more or less same, but little different. We will stress upon that different portions in our coming lecture. So, first, specimen handling and block selection. In case of pediatric kidney tumor, the whole specimen should be weighed, measured, three-dimensional measurement should be taken, and it should be photographed. Photography allows difficult cases to be discussed in the multidisciplinary meeting later on. Any area of rupture or fissuring should be identified, and any suspicious areas should be inked in different color from the rest of the specimen. The specimen should not be decapsulated, as this makes determination of growth beyond the capsule impossible. Any perirenal or perihilar lymph node should be blocked. The renal vein, renal artery, ureter, all should be identified. And a transverse section block of each taken near the resection margins. The surface of the whole specimen and the renal sinus should be inked, and it should be allowed to dry before opening the specimen. Otherwise, the ink spillage will occur, and it will be difficult the interpretation of the margin status. The specimen should be opened with a longitudinal incision by bulbing, and the tumor should be revealed, and its relation to the kidney, capsule, the renal sinus should be demonstrated. While examining the cut surface, you should check the extent of tumor necrosis and whether any cystic changes are present or not. The histopathology report must include the size of the tumor in 3D and the percentage of non-viable tumor, particularly in cases of NSCT treated tumors. Now, sometimes the samples are required for cytogenetic study in case of pediatric tumors, because some tumors have some genetic abnormalities underneath. So at least two pieces of morphologically different part of the tumor should be sampled, and it should be immediately SNAP frozen. If a biopsy is performed prior to the preoperative chemotherapy, then a sample of this should also be frozen. A mirror sample of the tumor adjacent to the frozen sample should be fixed in formalin and studied for histology. At the same time, 10 ml of peripheral blood in EDTA anticoagulant should also be taken. Now, the block selection. The sample for histological examination should include at least one longitudinal slice of the tumor, and this is called tumor mapping. The macroscopical different areas of the tumor should be sampled, as well as the sinus lymph node and other lymph nodes. Renal pelvis and lymphatic patch, ureter and sinus vessels should also be blocked. The renal vein should be inspected for evidence of any tumor thrombi. If present, it is critical to assess whether it is completely resected or not, whether it is attached to the wall of the vessel or not. Each nodule away from the main mass should be sampled in case of multifocal tumors. The tumor kidney interface and the tumor with kidney capsule should be sectioned. Area of the capsule that are suspected of being invaded by the tumor should also be blocked. Areas of perianal fat where the tumor infiltration is suspected should be taken. The areas of addition of the tumor to the surrounding tissues present should also be sampled, and at least 2 blocks of the normal kidney and blocks from abnormal looking areas in the remaining renal tissue should also be sampled. Now, this is the staging system of pediatric renal tumor done by Children's Oncology Group and International Society of Pediatric Oncology. The stage 1 tumors are mainly tumor limited to kidney and that is completely resected. The stage 2 tumors are tumor that infiltrates beyond the kidney but completely resected. The stage 3 tumors are involvement of any specimen, margin or tumor in the abdominal lymph node, any peritoneal contamination, residual tumor in the abdomen or tumor that was previously biopsied for anesthesia. Stage 4 tumors are tumor showing hematogenous metastasis or lymph node metastasis outside the abdominopelvic region. And the stage 5 tumor are bilateral renal involvement at the time of diagnosis. Now, what are the tumors that we are going to discuss? These are Quinn's tumor, the most common pediatric renal tumor. Next is mesoplastic nephroma, clear cell sarcoma, Rabdoid tumor of the kidney, and renal cell carcinoma, and some other tumors. In this picture, we are showing our transverse section of kidney in histological slide. The medial most portion is the renal sinus, which contains vessel as well as fat. First, we will discuss the Wilms tumor or nephroblastoma. Grossly, the tumor presents as large mass distorting the normal anatomical structure of kidney. Multicentricity is seen in the background of nephrogenic rest. The cur surface is solid, gray-white. Pseudocapsules may be present and cystic changes may occur. In this Quinn's tumor, the tumor is extending into the renal sinus. The cur surface is bulging, soft, friable with areas of necrosis and hemorrhage. Now, what are the histological features? The classical histological features of Quinn's tumor include a triphasic pattern of epithelial, stromal and the blastemal component. The proportion of different components may vary or it may present as a biphasic or monophasic pattern. In that case, diagnosis becomes difficult. Preoperative chemotherapy may alter the histology. This is a classical Wilms tumor with triphasic pattern. These are primitive tubules, these are blastemal cells, and this one is mesenchymal structure. This is another picture of biphasic tumor with tubules and the blastema. The tubules may get confused with the rosette of neuroblastoma, another common pediatric tumor. The features that go in favor of tubules are central lumen, single layer of lining, cell lining, the basal lamina, and the surrounding fibromatoid stroma. The blastema represents the least differentiated and presumed to be the most malignant component. Several histological patterns of blastema are recognized. Those are diffuse, serpentine, nodular, or basalar. All the 4 patterns may be present in the same tumor. These patterns do not have any prognostic significance. Now, this is a blastemal predominant Wilms tumor showing early epithelial differentiation, but no criteria has been set to discriminate the blastema from the early epithelial differentiation. This may be the tubular structure, sorry, epithelial structure. In the basaloid variant, the nest of cords of blastema have a distinctive peripheral calcium of elongated cells with epithelial differentiation. Diffuse growth pattern lacks the pseudocapsule and may infiltrate into the surrounding tissue. Here, the blastema is showing serpentine appearance. The abortive tubular structures with a differentiated epithelial lining can be found. The serpentine pattern of growth is characterized by broad bands of undifferentiated cells surrounded by fibromyxoid stroma. Here we are showing the blastema consisting of randomly arranged, densely packed small cells with dark blue nuclei with frequent mitotic activity and inconspicuous cytoplasm. This abortive glomerular structure, other than tubule, this glomerular structure may present in the Ewing's tumor as a focus foci of epithelial differentiation. The epithelial component of Ewing's tumor is most often of nephrogenic type, in which various stages of tubular and glomerular differentiation are seen. The heterologous epithelial structures that may be present in the form of mucinous, squamous, or neuroepithelial cells. Here, Ewing's tumor with a predominantly tubular or epithelial pattern. Now, the mesenchymal element may show a heterologous element, like in this case, it has shown differentiation towards the skeletal muscle element. Rhabdoid-like cells basically are features of skeletal muscle differentiation. The stromal pattern may be nephrogenic. As I said, it may be myxoid, fibrous, smooth muscle, or adipose cell, that is homologous, or it may be heterologous in the form of skeletal muscle, which is most common, or it may be a cartilaginous or bony differentiation. Now, some Ewing's tumor show features of anaplasia. And what is anaplasia? Anaplasia is characterized by atypical multipolar mitotic figures along with nuclear enlargement and hyperchromasia. Here we are showing a feature anaplastic Ewing's tumor showing nuclear enlargement, hyperchromasia, and as well as some mitotic figures. Now, Ewing's tumor with anaplasia, 5 to 8% of all Ewing's tumor may show anaplasia. The criteria, as I said, it is large atypical multipolar mitotic figures with significantly enlarged hyperchromatic nuclei. It may be anaplasia may be focal or diffuse. The focal anaplasia is basically localized and completely excised. All other cases are basically diffuse anaplasia. The anaplastic tumors often express P53 on immunohistochemical stain. The recognition of anaplastic features are very essential as the outcome is adverse or bad. Here, the definition of focal anaplasia, that is clearly defined anaplasia within the primary tumor, anaplasia confined to the renal parenchyma, anaplasia not present within the vascular space, or no severe nuclear pleomorphism or hyperchromasia. In diffuse anaplasia, the anaplasia is multifocal, or it may present beyond the capsule, or anaplastic cells in the intrarenal or extrarenal vessels, renal sinus, extracapsular invasive sites, or metastatic depot. Anaplasia that is focal but with nuclear atypia approaching to the criteria of anaplasia or nuclear unrest present elsewhere in the tumor are also categorized in the diffuse anaplasia. Anaplasia present in biopsy or other incomplete tumor samples are also considered as diffuse anaplasia. Now, preoperative chemotherapy induced changes in Ewing's tumor. The changes include necrosis, hemorrhage, and fibrosis of varying degree. The blastemal components are most sensitive to chemotherapy, and the mature epithelial and the stromal components are least sensitive. The chemosensitive area show homogeneous eosinophilic areas on excision sample as a shadow or of pre-existing cells or structure. The histological assessment of the tumor responsiveness to chemotherapy is an important risk group stratification by SIO. The completely necrotic Ewing's tumor is regarded as a low risk tumor and requires less postoperative therapy than the Ewing's tumor from other groups. This is a picture of a preoperatively treated Ewing's tumor and the skeletal muscle differentiation and the cartilage can be seen in the form of some tubular structures are also present, but there is absence of blastema. current SIOP classification for predated renal tumor, that is risk group stratification. The predated tumor, the low risk group are tumors are mesoblastic nephroma, the cystic partially differentiated nephroblastoma, or completely necrotic nephroblastoma. The intermediate risks are nephroblastoma or risk tumor of epithelial, stromal, or mixed type, nephroblastoma of regressive type, or nephroblastoma with focal anaplasia. The high risk group are blastomal type nephroblastoma, or nephroblastoma showing diffuse anaplasia. And in the primary nephrectomy tumors, the low risk tumors are, that is, without preoperative chemotherapy tumors, the low risk tumors are mesoblastic nephroma and cystic partially differentiated nephroblastoma. The intermediate risk tumors are non-anaplastic nephroblastoma and its variants, and the nephroblastoma with focal anaplasia, and high risk tumor are nephroblastoma with diffuse anaplasia or clear cell sarcoma of kidney on a rapid tumor of the kidney. Here we are showing electron micrograph of Wilms tumor showing a primitive tubule. This is blastomal epithelial cells forming a lumen. Now, what are nephrogenic risks? The nephrogenic risks are abnormally persistent foci of embryonal cells with the potential of developing into Wilms tumor. It may be multifocal or diffuse, then it is called nephroblastomatosis. Two types of nephrogenic risks are seen, that is perilobar and intralobar. They consist of variable amount of blastema, epithelial and stromal component. Majority of them regresses and becomes fibrotic, and some may give rise to Wilms tumor. The perilobar risks occurs in hemihypertrophy and Beckwith-Waldman syndrome, that is 11p15 gene mutation, and intralobar risks are seen in WGR syndrome, where there is deletion of 11p13 gene, and in Denys-Dash syndrome, where there is point mutation in the 11p13 gene. In this picture, we are showing a perilobar nephroblastomatosis, massive enlargement of the kidney. This is normal kidney showing glomeruli, and this is perilobar nephroblastomatosis. The compact uniform blastema showing a nodular configuration, and the discrete interface, the adjacent parenchyma, is evident. This is the interface. And this perilobar nephrogenic rest, the periphery of the kidney, just beneath the capsule, this, the nephrogenic rests are present. Now, in this picture, we are showing intralobar nephroblastomatosis, blastema, and immature tubules. These are immature tubules. These are blastema blending into the surrounding normal kidney. Now, immunohistochemistry. The blastema is positive for WT1 and desmin, but not for the other muscle markers. The epithelial component is positive for WT1 and keratin. So both blastema and the epithelial component are positive for WT1. Stroma show weak WT1 positivity and other stain consistent with morphologic appearance. That means if the stroma show heterologous skeletal muscle differentiation, then it should be positive for desmin and myoglobin. And if this cartilaginous differentiation, then it will be positive for SIOP. Now, cystic variant of nephroblastic tumors. One is cystic partially differentiated nephroblastoma. The cross picture, from the cross picture, it is evident that it is the multilocular tumor. The mean diameter is 10 cm. The septa are thin and there are no expansile solid nodule. So microscopically, the cystic partially differentiated nephroblastoma is composed entirely of cysts separated by septa. The cysts are lined by flattened cuboidal or hobnail epithelium. The septa are variably cellular and contain undifferentiated and differentiated components. The cystic partially differentiated nephroblastoma is considered to be a part of a spectrum with cystic nephroblastoma and with the most extreme of another tumor, that is benign pediatric cystic nephroma. However, a recent genetic study has shown that the cystic nephroma is completely different tumor with the DICER1 mutation. There is cystic nephroma, gross appearance of cystic nephroma, entirely cystic tumor, showing multiple thin wall cysts. And cysts are lined by flattened cuboidal epithelium. but the septa doesn't contain any blastomatous element. If any blastomatous element is present, then the diagnosis of cystic nephroma is pediatric cystic nephroma is rejected. Now, what are the different diagnoses of Wilms tumor? In a blastoma predominant Wilms tumor, the differential diagnosis are neuroblastoma or PNET, or desmoplastic small lung cell tumor, or synovial sarcoma. The neuroblastoma are WT1 negative. It is positive for NB84. In PNET, CD99 positivity is diffuse and membranous. The desmoplastic small lung cell tumor show a different translocation, that is 11-22 translocation in EWS and WT1 fusion. The synovial sarcoma is positive for TLE1, BCL2, EMA, and BIMT. The epithelial component predominant Wilms tumor should be distinguished from metanephric adenoma and the benign tumor with CK7 negative, AMR negative, it is WT1 and CD57 positive. And the renal cell carcinoma, pediatric renal cell carcinoma, these are CD10 positive and hyperplastic predovar nephrogenic rest should also be differentiated from epithelial predominant Wilms tumor. Now, second entity, that is clear cell sarcoma. The clear cell sarcoma of kidney is the second most common pediatric malignant neoplasm. Most of the cases occur between the age of 2 and 3 years. The mean age of presentation is 36 months. The most common symptoms are abdominal mass and pain, abdomen. This tumor very commonly metastasizes and the sites of metastasis are lymph node, bone, lung and liver. The gross picture of clear cell sarcoma, it is large, well-circumscribed, concentric mass. The tumor arises from renal medulla. The CAR surface is homogeneous, tan in color and has a mucoid glistening appearance. The gross extension into the renal vein is seen in 5% of the cases. This is the renal vein and this is the tumor. The classic morphology of the clear cell sarcoma comprises of nests and pods of cells that are separated by irregularly spaced fibrovascular septa. The fibrovascular septa may either be delicate or a branching chicken-like appearance, or it may be more cellular. In this picture, the 4 to 10 pods of cells separated by fibrous septa are seen in clear cell sarcoma, giving a distinctive low power appearance. On higher power, the pod cells show clear cytoplasm and monotonous round oval nuclei with fine chromatin and indistinct nucleoli. This resembles orphanonia in nuclei of papillary carcinoma of thyroid. This clear cell sarcoma may infiltrate into the surrounding normal kidney. Here we are showing the engraftment of normal tubules. While diagnosis, this should be kept in mind, or it may be misinterpreted as epithelial component of Wilms tumor. Here we are showing another pattern of clear cell sarcoma. Basically, clear cell sarcoma may present histologically as different pattern, amalgamation of different pattern may coexist within the same tumor. Here we are showing a Verruca body type pattern, that is Verruca body that is found in schwannoma, we all know. In this tumor, the tumor cells are arranged in pericyting Verruca body type pattern. This clear cell sarcoma show positivity for BCL6 co-receptor or BCOR. Basically, two types of mutation are found in clear cell sarcoma in 85% of the cases. Thus, the clear cell sarcoma shows BCOR mutation or BCL6 co-receptor mutation, and rest 15% of the cases they show a translocation involving YHWH gene. These are various patterns of clear cell sarcoma. The most common pattern is myxoid's pattern, followed by sclerosing, cellular pattern, epithelioid pattern, pericyting pattern, as I shown, the spindle cell pattern, storiform, and the anaplastic pattern. Now, immunohistochemistry, traditionally the role of immunohistochemistry in this tumor is very minimal. The nerve growth factor receptor and cyclin are sensitive marker, but they are not specific at all. TLE, SATB2, BCL2, CD10 show variable and non-specific positivity. The CCSK is consistently negative for epithelial markers, neural markers and muscle markers. Now recently the diffuse strong nuclear staining with commercially available BCL6 co-receptor as shown, antibody has been shown to be highly sensitive and specific for the diagnosis of CCSK in the context of pediatric renal neoplasia. Now, what are the differential diagnoses of CCSK? That is blastemal predominant tumor, cellular congenital mesoblastic nephroma, and metanephrostomal tumor. The CCSK shows insidious growth pattern with entrapment of the renal tubules, frequently regularly spaced vessels, and fine nuclear chromatin. But blastemal predominant Wilms tumor are densely cellular, there is nuclear overlapping, molding, and there is heterologous chromal element. They are positive for WT1, whereas CCSK is positive for B-corocycline D1. The cellular congenital mesoblastic nephroma show Cushing border spindle cell morphology, and they lack the diversity of pattern of CCSK. The characteristic translocation involving chromosome 12 and 15, resulting in fusion of the ETB6 and MTRK3 gene, are found in cellular congenital mesoblastic nephroma. This fusion is also found in adult type fibrosarcoma. Now, metanephrostomal tumor, a recently described entity in the spectrum of pediatric renal tumors, they show angiodysplasia, onion skin growth around the tibial, juxtaglomerular cell hyperplasia, heterologous chromal element. This tumor is positive for CD34. Now, next entity is congenital mesoblastic nephroma. The congenital mesoblastic nephroma is a stromal neoplasm of infancy. It is composed of myofibroblasts and most commonly diagnosed in the first 3 months of life. That is, in the infancy, it is the most common renal neoplasm of infancy and presents as the abdominal mass. They arises from infantile renal sinus. The classic variant of CMN show no consistent genetic abnormality, whereas in cellular variant, they show translocation 12-15, resulting in ETB6 and NTRK3 fusion gene. This is the car surface of CMN, showing yellow-white bulging car surface and focal areas of hemorrhage. The classic pattern on histology, that is intersecting bundles of uniform bland spindle cells without nuclear atypia, mitosis is not evident. They are morphologically very much similar to infantile fibrosarcoma. CMN also infiltrate and may overgrow the normal renal elements like tubules or glomeruli. And dysplastic renal tubules are also seen, as well as the cartilage are often found in mesoblastic nephroma. The cellular mesoblastic nephroma in the low power view, it shows the hemangiopericytoma-like blood vessels. The high power shows mitosis, the mitosis and pycnotic cells, and moderate nuclear atypia, enlarged nuclei and the vesicular chromatin, and small nucleoli. These tumors have a pushing border and are composed of proliferant fascicles. The tumors show high mitotic rate. The mixed CNM, that is composed of both classic and cellular CMN, are also found. The immunoreactivity for actin and for desmin are seen. They are non-reactive to CD34 as opposed to metanephrostomal tumor. The ultrastructurally, these tumors have the features of myofibroblast or fibroblast. Now, rhabdoid tumor, they comprise 2% of all renal neoplasm of children. The mean age of presentation is approximately 1 year. 80% of the patients are diagnosed in the first 2 years of life. Hematuria and abdominal pain are the most common mode of presentation. The primary extrarenal rhabdoid tumors can be seen in both children as well as in the adults, particularly in the CNS neoplasm. The unifying feature at all sites, the presence of mutation or deletion of INI1 gene located at chromosome 12, long arm of chromosome 12, the band 11. Grossly rhabdoid tumor is usually round, pale, soft, and unencapsulated. Satellite tumors may also be present. There is diffuse growth of the neoplastic cells, the monomorphic neoplastic cells. They are overrunning native glomeruli. The cells show eccentrically placed enlarged nucleus with prominent conspicuous eosinophilic nucleoli and abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm. The vascular invasion is usually extensive. They show cytological triad of, as I said, vesicular chromatin, chromin and cheruvate, the eosinophilic nucleoli, and hyaline pink cytoplasm inclusions. Loss of SMARCB1, also known as INI1, on immunohistochemistry, the sensitive and specific marker for this neoplasm. Now another tumor, that is ossifying renal tumor of infancy. This intracalicial mass composed of osteoid trabeculae, osteoblast-like cells, and spindle cell component. The tumor arises from the medullary pyramid. The usual age of presentation is 6 days to 2 years. There is striking male predominance. The three major components are thin, the osteoid core containing osteoblastic cells, and peripherally a bland spindle stroma is seen. Now the renal cell carcinoma. This malignant epithelial tumor are rare in children, but clear cell RCC are found in case of vulnerable Lindau syndromes. The papillary RCC is the most common histological subtype of RCC in children. Renal medullary carcinoma is another entity. It appears to be a distinctive molecular signature that clusters closely with the urothelial cells, urothelial carcinoma of renal pelvis. The presenting symptoms are flank pain, hematuria, and a palpable abdominal mass. It is medullary carcinoma, the seed-like arrangement of the cells, infiltrated by acute and chronic inflammatory cells. The cells are highly pleomorphic with enlarged nuclei, vesicular chromatin, and conspicuous nucleoli. The stroma are often desmoplastic, and there is inflammatory cell infiltration in the interface of the stroma and the tumor. Now, another common renal cell carcinoma in children are translocation associated renal cell carcinoma. I discussed in the last class. Majority of the translocation involve the TFE3 gene located at short arm of chromosome X. These tumors have a nested or tubular papillary pattern and are composed of cells with voluminous clear cytoplasm and with a distinct cell border and enlarged nuclei. And the cell nests are separated by thin fibrovascular sector. So finally, a complete report of pediatric renal tumor should include the total weight of the kidney and the kidney with the tumor, the size of the specimen, the size of the tumor, all three-dimensional measurements should be given, the location of the tumor, if the tumor is multifocal or unifocal, whether the specimen was received intact from the operation theater, or it has already been cut open. If the renal capsule is grossly intact or it is ruptured, the surface, whether inked or not before opening the kidney, the percentage of necrosis or regressive change on the gross examination, and same on the microscopy examination, percentage of blastema, the proportion of viable tumor, the presence of any anaplastic necroblastoma or anaplastic feature, and if it is present, whether it is focal or it is diffuse, the presence of perineal fat invasion, presence of renal sinus invasion, presence of renal vein tumor, if the resection margin is involved, if involved, whether it is involved by a viable tumor or a non-viable tumor, whether lymph node has been examined or not, histological diagnosis and subtype, the tumor is grouped, local tumor staging using the SIOP system. These are references from where I have made this PPT. And thank you for your patient hearing.